Hello, everyone. Welcome into the ArtWalk Podcast. My name is Aaron Massey. I'm going to be your host for this discussion. Today, we have a wonderful guest. His name is Andy Rossi. He is an actor, comedian, filmmaker, and we're going to get into a lot of fun stuff. He's got a new movie coming out called Dead Body, and we're going to talk about filmmaking, acting, being a young man, going west out to LA, and a lot of fun topics around that. If you haven't done so already, just a couple orders of business. You can subscribe to the ArtWalk newsletter at artwalk.substack.com. There you will get a nice little subscription to Five Cool Things, which is a newsletter that comes to your inbox every Friday morning, detailing fun, cool stuff like film and television, artists, photographers, some writing and books, cool things to check out on a weekly basis for your entertainment, as well as updates on this podcast, which will live there, as well as Spotify, iTunes, and Google Podcasts. And if you'd like to watch this, you can do so on YouTube. And those links will be located down below for you to click on. Once again, thank you so much for joining us. Let's get into the episode. This is Andy Rossi. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome into the ArtWalk Podcast. I am joined today by the infamous, notoriously hilarious comedian, filmmaker, writer, Mr. Andy Rossi.
Wow. Thank you so much. Notorious. That's what you want to be known for.
Just like Biggie said, man.
And now I got it in my head, yeah.
But we can come up with if you were like the Notorious Rossi.
Notorious Rossi?
Yeah.
I like that.
All right. Well, you're at least now creating a character.
We just stumbled on brilliance.
Yeah. Yeah. Welcome, man. How you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you? I wore the sweater for our listeners or viewers that can see. I have what I call an old man sweater, but I guess it's more of like if I were working in a library, I would wear this sweater because your podcast makes me feel all nice and cozy. You want us to get like comfortable and relaxed. So that's how I wanted to feel today.
Well, you look cozy and warm and it makes me feel warm inside too. It's nice. We are approaching the age of the old man's sweaters. So,
and yeah, maybe it's just the sweater now.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I tend to wear cardigans and Mr. Rogers sweaters here in Ohio in the wintertime. It's nice. It's easy. Just throw it on in the morning.
Is that a style, Mr. Rogers style?
I think it is.
Yeah, it should be.
Yeah. And I can guarantee you probably not many are taking advantage of it out in LA.
Yeah. So you need to get on it.
Yeah. You could be at the forefront of a new revolution. You guys are going back in trends. Everything's all trendy there. You can do it.
Yeah. I'll try it out. See what happens. Well, Notorious Rossi will just wear Mr. Rogers outfits.
I love it, man. So welcome into this podcast. As you can already tell, it's going to get a little silly on this one. Because Andy brings out the funny side in me, and he's always funny himself. So we're going to get into a lot of conversations based around filmmaking, writing, movies, comedy. We're going to get into all of it. It's going to be a lot of fun, so stick around. So full disclosure. Now, you are a friend of mine, and I'm starting this podcast with a lot of people that I know personally, because that's pretty much what you need to do. Mm-hmm. But it does not take away the talent level of the people I know, because I'm surrounded by so much talent. And we're going to get into it, but Andy just recently wrote and directed a movie called Dead Body, which is taking the film festival circuit by storm. Do you, actually, before we get into Dead Body, I think we should maybe tell the folks do you want to go into our background and let people know how we came to be pals?
Yeah, you know, it's the age-old story. One guy is trying to be an actor, so works as a DJ, and another guy does just the same. And they meet, and fireworks happen. I think that's our story. No, yeah, we were both from the DJ. We both work for a DJ company, DJing weddings.
Yeah, and it was actually a really good gig for me because it allowed me to keep my weeks open because I would DJ Fridays, Saturday nights, weekends were wrecked. But at that point, like, I didn't have any money to go spending out in LA at that point. So I was happy to work weekends. And then you could keep your weeks open for auditions or, you know, getting on set, you know, doing background work or stand-in work or hopefully booking something during the week.
And I'm still doing this, just so we're clear. I'm still DJing.
Yeah.
So.
And with rave reviews, I understand. He's like one of the most, and he's one of the most sought after DJs in LA. Am I wrong?
I'm not going to say you're not right.
There you go. Yeah.
Or is that right?
Sure.
I don't know. But yeah, no, I'm still doing it. And it's really been a great way to be creative during the week because you kind of got weekends to, you know, which DJing itself, I think, is a pretty creative kind of fun job for the most part, because you're just entertaining guests and playing music and being on the microphone. And for me, actually, it's really helped with auditions, because if I can talk on a microphone in front of 200 people on their most important day on a wedding, then, you know, it makes it a little easier for me to, you know, shoot a self tape in my, you know, room. So I think it's been a really helpful kind of way to, you know, get rid of the nerves and the anxiety that comes in with auditioning and performing. You're kind of just like, I've been doing this every weekend. So
yeah, that's a great point. I remember that. I remember when I first started getting into it and knowing that I had to do announcements in front of 150, 200, 250 people, but I was up there by myself with a microphone. I was like, okay, well, it's sink or swim time. So you just do it. And then you build a confidence of like talking in front of people. And in particular that, like, you're kind of going off the cuff sometimes. You're just riffing.
Absolutely.
And, you know, I didn't have a ton of stage experience. I kind of got that as I trained in LA. Did you have much stage experience as an actor before?
No, not at all. When I started DJing, especially, I was always anti-microphone. I grew up in the Midwest and like, I thought it was cheesy to be like, hey, everyone, let's get everybody on the dance floor. But I really wanted to DJ, and like, I wanted to DJ at clubs and stuff. So when I first started working where we both worked, I was like, I don't want to talk on the microphone. I would write down everything I was going to say, like, hello, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the cake cutting. Like, it was so bad. But you get comfortable after a while.
What's the hot song right now? I've been out of the game for a while.
Oh gosh. Anything Doja Cat.
The only reason I know Doja Cat is from an episode of Dave, which
that's true. Huh?
If you haven't seen Dave, it's so good. That show is so good.
We have a mutual friend that was on Dave. Who? Did you catch Sam Mara, AKA Neon?
Yeah, actually I do. He was, oh my God, I'm trying to remember what he did, but I remember that I caught him. I was like, hey,
yeah,
Sam's in debt.
I know that guy.
Yeah. Do you have a do you have a favorite weddings DJ story, or like what's the craziest wedding that you DJed?
I'd say just recently I got to go out to Mexico and go to a town called San Miguel de Allende, and this party was crazy. Usually you go to like a Mexico wedding, you would think, oh, I'll bring 12 of my friends. They brought like 200 of their friends. And it was, DJs would know that a 4-hour dance set is long. So I knew, I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to play like every song I've ever heard, because that's a lot of time. But they got after it by the end. Two things happened, Aaron. One, every dude had their shirt off at the end of the night. And two, they had all for the groom went with mustaches. So just at the end of the night, I'm DJing in Mexico with like 60 sweaty dudes with their shirts off, all with mustaches. So for me, I'm like, There it is. It's not going to get any better than that.
They came with mustache, or did they shave mid?
All of them came with mustaches, okay, of different varieties. And the groom, the bride, I guess, said, like, well, I don't want you to have a mustache in our pictures. So he had a beard. But by the end, he did leave during the reception, came back full mustache.
Okay.
So I was pretty bummed because I didn't get the mustache memo. I would have cooked one up, you know, as we talked about. I can grow facial hair pretty quick. So I would have had that fresh, ready to go. But, you know, I'd shaved that morning. So
just pull out the electric shaver in the middle of chain smokers. Just
yeah, why not?
let's go. It was a good run for me. I enjoyed it. And any aspiring actors, maybe look into it, because it's a nice way
to
keep your
week. I should
open.
Tell you that you should know this, that when I first started, you were there before me, and I remember seeing you DJ, or maybe I just met you. I think I met you at the Shade Hotel, perhaps. I think you were doing a gig, and I had heard that you had done something like, not a lot, but you're like, yeah, Aaron's done like 12 weddings or whatever it was. And I remember going, oh my God, like, I can't even, he's done 12 of these. Like, and now I'm like, you know, I've probably done like 800 weddings at this point. I started in 2006. So, but I just remember like thinking like, I'm like, how did he do all those? But
yeah, we've been to more weddings in this world than probably the, you know, most people in the States combined. I don't know.
Yeah.
We've been to so many weddings.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, getting off the wedding kick, let's give people what they came for.
Yeah.
Let's get right into it, man. Let's get right into like the newest, greatest thing that's happening right now, which is Dead Body. And then we'll backtrack into kind of like your history and background and creativity and stuff. But, why don't you tell the audience what is Dead Body and what is going on with it right now?
Yeah. So I wrote a story called Dead Body, and it came from an acting exercise I did. So I was in acting class, and my scene was about two guys getting rid of a dead body. And it was for my scene partner, for his like reel. And it was like really dark and very like dramatic and like tough. It was like a tough scene. And during it, I don't know, in the back of my mind, I kept going, this could be hilarious. Like, and I kept kind of interjecting some comedy, and like our acting teacher's like, no, this is not funny. So I'm like, but I want to make it funny. So I just kind of like, as a writing exercise, just kind of wrote out some stuff where I thought, what would happen if these guys were getting rid of a dead body? And it was kind of funny. And it just, for like the first time, it actually flowed pretty, not easy, but easier than most writing I struggle with. There's stuff I started, you know, decades ago that I still haven't, you know, I'm doing air quotes, completed. But this one, like, I kept writing and I'm like, this is fun. And I was just like, very like, since it was comedy and silly, it was kind of like, eh, yeah, I'll throw that in there. I wasn't like second guessing myself very much. So I had like a pretty decent story and I thought it'd be like a good short. And then did a table read where I think I had like maybe 40 pages done. And when we did the table read, you were there and a few other great actors and people in the industry, and kind of were like, I think we could turn this into a feature. So we added like four new scenes. And then the next thing you know, we got a feature. And yeah, we shot it in July with Aaron Massey as the lead, with James Shippey also as the lead. And kind of nothing was really happening during COVID. So we had time to do like some post-production. And then once kind of like the festivals were starting to kick around, you know, it took a while, but now we're getting some good traction. And I think, yeah, it's gotten into five festivals as of this time, and all within like the last 2 months. So it's been pretty chaotic. We started in New York, and now we've been in LA a couple of times. We have a screening tonight. So yeah, it's been pretty awesome to get some people to check it out.
It's awesome, man. I'm so happy it spawned an idea and you wrote it and completed it and we made a movie.
Yeah.
And it's pretty cool. And so tonight's at Culver City, correct?
Yeah. So Culver City Film Festival has their screening at the Cinemark, which is in that Howard Hughes Center off the 405. And yeah, so looking forward to that. It'll be my second time seeing it on the big screen. The first time was It was great, man. Like, I really missed you. I wish you were there. You would have loved it.
I know. Being stuck here in the Midwest doesn't allow me to hit a lot of those nice LA events that I used to be able to.
It's interesting though, because of, I think primarily because of COVID, I looked through like the cast and a lot of people are in different states. You're not the only one. I think when we shot it, you were like the only person that wasn't currently living in Los Angeles. And now it's like, there's a lot. So I think, you know, it was tough, you know, during all that time for people to stay out here. So
everyone just left.
this place. And I think this went back home or something.
We shot it in 2019.
Yep.
And pretty much you're doing post the end of that year into 2020. So timing wise, I don't think anyone really knew what was going to happen once pandemic kind of started in 2020. Especially like film festivals, obviously everything just canceled and no one was making stuff, obviously, for a year or less than. So it took a while to get things back up. So in a way, it was kind of nice that you had a piece of work to be able to show and work on, like finishing it like just before that all happened. So it was kind of fortunate, you know.
Yeah, it was crazy because I was really nervous. I mean, as everybody was, especially like artists, like, what do we do, you know, when we can't go out and do stuff? But yeah, luckily we had shot everything already. So now it was, for me, like a good learning experience because I didn't know anything about, you know, color correcting or even like sound design or, you know, working with a composer, and I wasn't rushed, you know. So like, speaking of my composer, like him and I like did like sessions kind of like you and I are right now on Zoom, and he would just put things together and I go, yeah, I like that. Or yeah, or let's try to work with that. It was really cool. And I felt no pressure to be like, I need this done by like this day. So it was kind of nice to actually have that time to just concentrate on the post stuff that I had no idea how much, you know, I was getting myself into. So it was kind of nice to have that time.
This is your first feature film.
Yep. First feature.
Yeah. So Andy's done a lot of short sketches that's out to the world. I'll link the Dead Body trailer down below in the comments, and then any other little shorts you want me to link, I'll put in there too.
Cool.
We'll discuss so people can check that out and see what
you edited that trailer, man, and that trailer is awesome.
I did edit the trailer. Hopefully people liked it and got some attention. So I mean,
it's so good.
I don't really consider myself a top tier editor, and cutting a trailer is so difficult, like at least for me, because you're having to fill an entire feature into basically, you know, what is it, like 2 minutes roughly, two and a half, a lot of trailers. And so doing enough to give, you know, to get people interested in the project, not give away too much, but, and then make sure that it kind of has some sort of storyline throughout that people can connect to. And it's tough to know like what to choose. And especially with a movie like that, where there's, you're laughing all the way through it. So there's so many things that you want to use, but you're like, ah, we should maybe save that. That's a good one.
Yeah.
You know, let's not show that. So it's finding that balance. So it was a challenge, cutting that, but yeah, I'm glad. I think it turned out really well, and, hopefully we'll garner some more interest. So you're still waiting on some more film festivals, cause people are probably wondering like, hey, how do I see this? Mm-hmm. I know you had told me you're still waiting on a few in terms of whether, you know, you can get the film in or not. And then from there, obviously, like, not sure. Do you have a direction that you're trying to take it, or you're kind of up in the air right now waiting for like distribution stuff?
Yeah, I think I'm learning as I go. And luckily, you know, I have people like you and Andre, who do a great job of kind of like helping out with that sort of thing. Because like you said, I'm a first time feature filmmaker. So kind of figuring it out as I go, even with the festivals, you know, right in the beginning, I was trying for like the big dogs, you know, the big festivals, and they said, nope, not interested. So I'm like, okay, let me go more towards like what my film is, a dark comedy, you know, Evil Dead tone, game night tone, I think. So it's not like your film that you're going to see at Sundance, you know? So we had to find the festivals that it works really well with. So once I kind of figured that out, I think it's been super helpful. And I think distribution wise, you know, once I get that going, and I would like to kind of stick around with the festivals for a bit just to kind of get some eyes on it and get some opinions and whatnot. But it's cool. Even with the festivals, I've met some people that are kind of steering me in the direction of distribution and how to do all that kind of stuff. So I'd say for anybody listening, if you check out Dead Body Movie on Instagram, you could kind of figure out where our next festival is going to be. We actually have one coming up in a couple of weeks that's all virtual. So anybody around the planet can watch it, which is actually, I guess, kind of the silver lining of the pandemic is with the festivals, the ones that stuck around are able to do virtual and kind of pivoted that way. So you can get, you know, people, I'm from Chicago, so my friends and family from Chicago got to, you know, see it without having to fly to LA or New York. So that's been pretty cool.
I think that's the trend that's going to continue. I think film festivals are now realizing because of when they first had to go virtual because of 2020, they realized, well, we can pretty much just open this up to anybody. And then you can purchase the rental from the site, from the film festival website. It helps them because they can bring in more financing that way and open it up after it premieres, likely if it is a physical screening as well. But I don't see that changing. I don't think Mm-mm. I think it would be foolhardy for any film festival to disregard the ability to send it out to anyone. So I guess in essence, if anything has come from it, I think that's a good thing because you can get more exposure where people don't have to necessarily travel to a Sundance or Telluride or South by Southwest to actually see your film. So that's pretty cool. I do think there's a lot of value though still in that face-to-face meeting people, especially for filmmakers and actors. It's really nice to get in the room and rub elbows with people. And you're getting to experience that with Studio City, right? And then obviously Culver City, where some are still only doing it as a virtual event. So you've already won awards for this. So you want to tell the folks what Dead Body's already taken home so far?
Yeah, it's so crazy, man. Like it's such a small film that was just like everybody that's in it we're all like friends now, and it's like a really tight group, but everyone I knew. So it was all like people from classes or from DJ or from the Groundlings. So it's crazy that it's even been mentioned in awards. So, I mean, we went to Soho, New York for the Soho Film Festival, and I just went because I'd never been to New York City. Sound like such a small town guy saying that, but just never found my way over there. So just decided like, hey, you know what? I had some airline credits from the year before at canceling flights, so let's do it. So we went to Soho and just wanted to be there just to kind of, like you said, rub elbows, meet some people. And so we kind of had a seat in the back where we're just like, let's just watch this. You know, there was like open bar or whatever. And then the next thing you know, towards the end of the ceremony, I hear, and the nominees are Dead Body. And I'm like, wait, what? We're nominated? Like, we had no idea we were even nominated for anything. So yeah, we won. I think the first one we won was the Best Feature Audience Award, which means anybody that watched it online, they could vote. So our film won that category. And then as we were walking away from that one, we won, which I think is super awesome. We won the Best Ensemble Award, which means, you know, we had the best for that film festival. We had the best cast, which I thought was super cool because I think that's what I'm most proud of, is like the people that we all, you know, got together, and, you know, to get an award for that was really cool. And then we went to LA Film Festival and won the audience award for that one too, Best Feature. And one, they have a category, they have like different budgets, and our budget's pretty low. So we won what's called the Best Feature No Budget. So we won that one. So yeah, really, really, really crazy. I still am like very confused, but excited.
Well, it's deserved. It's deserved. You know, you can be confused, but...
it's just, you don't expect that kind of stuff. So, you know, it's cool when you get, you're not, you don't do it for awards. I don't think, you know, right. Hopefully people don't. So when you get them, you're like, what?
Yeah.
This was just fun. Like, you're rewarding me for the fun. That's cool.
I think that's when it's the most special, is when you make something just to make something. I don't want to say that the wrong way. Like, making something just to make something. You make something for the experience of making something, right? The enjoyment of that process. And then, you know, I've never been a trophy guy, an awards guy. I've always turned my head away from that stuff. Because it's all subjective and there's no, it mm-hmm. doesn't mean anyone's better than the other person in art particular, like the Oscars. I have a hard time because it's a special night. And it means a lot, being in our industry, but at the same time, it's like, we're all just like patting ourselves on the back, you know what
yeah,
I mean?
It's so ridiculous.
It's a little bit awkward at the same time, but that being said, to get recognition for the work that you've put in, and some people might see that as silly. It's like, oh, you're just playing, you're just acting or making a movie. And it's like, well, people actually work really hard, and making a movie is extremely difficult to do. Most people set out to do it. They don't finish it, or they'll never just even get started in the first place. And so, especially with something like you did, where you have a large cast, multiple locations, and just turning it out and making it work, I think to get the recognition is nice and it's special. And so, you know, you take that for what it's worth, and, you know, hopefully it just helps lend to more people seeing it because of the recognition and saying, oh, maybe I should check this out. And I think that's what then maybe that leads towards, you know?
Yeah. I mean, that's the whole goal, is that people watch it. So if you could say, oh yeah, it actually won a couple of awards, I think it entices people to be like, oh, well, maybe I'll check it out now.
Yeah.
It's won awards.
Yeah.
And it's cool because it's comedy. And like you said about the Oscars doesn't have like a comedy category. So I always think it's so cool. Like Melissa McCarthy, I think, has been nominated twice. I think once was for Bridesmaids, which is to me is awesome to be like, you were so funny in that movie that they're giving you an Oscar nomination. So it's tough. Yeah. Cause like most awards, it's very serious, very dramatic. You know, you got to turn yourself into a different person, and, you know, you have to be, you know, I'm trying to think of this. I was going to say Muhammad Ali. Will Smith is Muhammad. Like, you have to be Johnny Cash. You have to like become someone else, you know,
yeah.
For the most part.
Yeah. Yeah. It's special, man. And I congratulations from me to you. I'll just say that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So the film, I can't say right now at this moment while we're having this podcast where to go watch it yet, but I think maybe down the road, there's good possibility. At least it could be on like an Amazon for rent, mm-hmm. something like that. So stay tuned with that. But the links will be down below to check it out for sure. What was your biggest challenge making it, just as a first time independent filmmaker saying, hey, I want to do this. Like, what was the hardest part of it for you?
I mean, there were so many things, but I think just kind of leading it pretty much on my own. It's not like I had like a huge crew. Luckily we had, you know, Andre. Has Andre come on the show yet, or is he coming on?
I interviewed him a few days ago. So,
oh, perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're getting that episode together.
Nice. So Andre was the DP on it, and thank God, because dude is super talented. So I thankfully had him, and I had my buddy Corey is awesome with sound. So I had those two things kind of covered, where I'm like, all right, sound and DP, which I still today think are the two most important things to have on your film in your crew. So I think after that, it was like, I got to do this on my own. So literally like buying props and getting wardrobe and finding people to do makeup, and, you know, found a great special effects person, like just being in charge of everything. And then on the shoot day, being in charge of all that. So I think the most challenging thing was dealing with your surroundings. So your first day of shooting was, we found out at our shooting location, was construction day. It was literally like saws and sanders and hammering, like the loudest you can possibly imagine, like just a few doors down from where we were shooting. And our sound person was like, no, this is not going to work. So it was just like, I think we were there for like 3 or 4 hours with nothing. I mean, we could shoot video, but so I was even like, shoot, this is like one of my first days and I have to do ADR after this. I don't know how to do that. So it was just that. And then we shot another scene where right when we started, all these lawnmowers, you know, started going off. So it was just like this dealing with all that kind of stuff, I think was the most most challenging, especially like we didn't have another option. So it's like, if we lose today, you know, that's it. We got to get everything in. So, yeah.
I remember the loudness. It was like, oh man, this is going to be a rough start. But I mean, made it work. And I couldn't hear anything. And, you know, I couldn't hear any like crazy stuff going on in the background.
I think we got a shot in there. There's a shot of the actual sign that says like pardon our dust or something like that. And I'm like, I'm glad that's in there just in case a viewer is like, sounded kind of loud in there.
Yeah.
You're like, oh yeah, it was part of the movie.
Yeah.
It was part of it.
Yeah. What inspired you to write this? You have a long history of comedy and being involved with the Groundlings, correct?
Yeah.
I know you said that you worked on it like a scene in there. I guess I should ask you this, kind of what inspires you to create this type of comedy, making things on film? Like what is that for you that kind of drives you?
It's weird for me. Like you probably similar to me, like on my phone, I have so many things on like my notes and I have like notebooks with this like tons of ideas and just like, you know, throughout the years you just think of stuff, but a lot of times I just kind of hit a wall. I'll be like, oh, that would be funny or that would be cool, and then I got nowhere to go. Like it's kind of like, and then maybe even years pass and I'm like, oh, that's kind of like that other idea I had. So this one just so happened to just flow. Like it was just like, what if they had the dead body, and then what if they had to do this, then what if they go there? I don't know, it just like all went like pretty quickly. And then like I said, doing the table read was helpful too, because I got some other outside. It's always helpful, I think, to send it to your friends and have people that are kind of doing the same thing take a look and be like, maybe some suggestions or something. I always give you a credit for in our film. I guess I shouldn't ruin too many things in case people do go see it. But there's a scene we originally were supposed to shoot at the Bed Bath & Beyond. And it just wasn't going to work out because I don't even know how do you get permits for that and whatnot. So we changed the scene. Aaron had an idea and we went with it. And I think it's one of my favorite scenes in the movie now. So I guess I kind of lost track of the question you asked me.
Just, but it's all right. We went from inspiration to basically like Clean Larry.
Which makes sense.
Yeah.
But
Clean Larry is a character in the film that I don't know how much Andy wants to give away, but it's something where we had to replace Bed Bath & Beyond for another scene. And we were just brainstorming and I had a thought about, hey, why don't we just do it like in an alley with a character? And it turned into this guy that you created. And then, the scene's pretty funny. So, And that is actually a great example of being an independent filmmaker. And, you know, you write, a lot of times you do have to write in a box. Like if you're the one writing the script or whoever is writing the script for a low budget or no budget indie, you know, you kind of have to start with what do you have? And then from there, especially when you're shooting in LA, like you can't really shoot in locations because they're going to want $10,000, $15,000, $30,000 a day, if that's probably on the low end, to shoot at their location. And there's no way we're getting Bed Bath & Beyond. So you have to kind of fix or like limit what you can do and where you can shoot with what you already have. Or if you want to go into that guerrilla style type filmmaking where you're just going for it and shooting on the streets, and hopefully nobody stops you, get it in quick and go.
Yeah. And I think it's a deterrent sometimes when you run into stuff like that. Like I've done other shorts. I did a short film that actually you were a part of. I don't even know if you remember. A long time ago, I tried to do a short and it just like, I just didn't have all the pieces together. And like the footage was okay. Our sound wasn't great. And just like, I honestly just kind of went, well, I guess that's not going to happen, you know, and it happens. But if you keep persistent about it and think of other ways to do it, then I think that's the only way you can do it, because you're going to run into a lot of situations where you're just going to have to be like, okay, what else can we do? And you just got to, you know, adapt.
You started more as an actor, right? I mean, you are an actor and you lean on the comedy end of things, but Andy also has a part in my film that I'm completing called Midwest, and I made him go drama. And I thought he crushed it. Actually, the scene's on YouTube. I just realized that. I remember that. I put the scene as a like a little teaser on YouTube. I'll link it below if you want to check it out. But that's nice. Andy in a drama, more of a dramatic scene with my lead character, Rick. Rick Huddleston plays Jake. And so when did you, I always like going to origin stories because it's interesting for me to hear it. When did you want to start acting? Was that the first thing? Were you like enamored by movies at a young age?
Yeah. Yeah. For me, I look back at it now and I wish as a kid, you can kind of vocalize that to your parents or something. But, you know, I grew up in a very blue collar, you know, I grew up in Chicago. My dad's an electrician. Actually, majority of my relatives are electricians. Nobody really nobody at all was in the industry, nor did anyone think of that. You can do that as an occupation. So as a kid, my dad would actually nickname me Mr. Movie because I'd be back and forth to the, you know, Video Nuts, which was our video store where I ride my bike and, you know, grab VHS tapes. And my mom will talk about the story a lot. The older lady that worked there is her and her husband. They would only have like one or two copies of the VHS back in the day. So if you wanted to see like Batman Forever, you needed to get there and be there right when somebody returned it. But she would put my name above other people's names because I was, you know, one of her biggest customers. So she would call me and be like, Andy, your Batman Forever is available. And I'd ride my bike over and go get it. So I was super into movies at a young age. And I would, when I had like friends over, I'd be like, hey guys, I got a video camera. You guys want to go in the basement and shoot like usually it was like a superhero movie, or it was always like shooting people and I think I love Van Damme. So it was all like, it'd be like two guys like facing off in like a street fight in like my parents' basement. I even did like a parody of SNL in my parents' basement, just with a camera. But I just thought it was fun. I'm just like, oh, this is cool. You know, I like doing this kind of thing. I never ever in my brain was like, I'm going to then do acting. You know, I just went the route of everybody else, you know, go to high school, you go to college. And then it wasn't until college that I took an acting class, and it was like my whatever senior year of college. And I was like, oh man, this is awesome. And literally from there, I was like, I need to do this forever. And like you, I was an athlete. So, you know, in high school, I didn't do any plays or anything like that. I was, you know, I played baseball, football, wrestling. So I was involved with that, and didn't really take advantage of theater. And I really wish I would have, but I don't think I like knew, you know, that I could do that until, you know, I got older, I guess.
Well, I think too, in high school, at least it was, I mean, if you're playing baseball and football, like the schedules just didn't work out because theater was right after school as well. And yeah. So it was practice. So you had to choose one or the other. And in a weird way, like, maybe that's why there's always been this big disconnect between like, you know, the theater kids and the athletes, because like there's no opportunity for you to connect. I don't know. I'm just realizing weird. Some stuff now, I guess. I don't know. Until college, I was similar. Like I took an acting class like my junior year after I blew my shoulder out and I was done playing baseball. It's like, all right, let's start doing some stuff that I want to do. I wanted to play baseball, but extra stuff like that, like you said. It's like you always had interest in it, but there was always a block of some sort.
So yeah, and it's weird. Sorry. I was just gonna say it's weird too, because growing up in Chicago, there was like, it's a huge theater, you know, area with Steppenwolf and they also, for comedy, they have Second City is out there. I just didn't know. Like, I didn't realize that stuff was even there. Cause as a kid, I just went to Chicago to go party, you know, or go like take the train down and, you know, drink on the way with my friends and go to a baseball game or something. So I never, it never even like crossed my mind until I moved all the way across the country to LA. And then I was like, wait, there's that stuff is in Chicago? Huh. Didn't even know.
Yeah. So you didn't go to any of that stuff. You didn't go to any comedy, Second City, any Steppenwolf productions at all when you lived there.
Can you believe that? Yeah, it's embarrassing. I have gone since and I'm like, this was here the whole time. Oh my God.
Well,
but I think, I think it's like almost being a tourist in that town. Like I grew up there. So like people ask me, you know, if they go out to Chicago, they're like, what do I go do? And I'm always like, you know, I'm like, I don't know. I don't know where the cool spots are. You know, I know where I went when I lived out there. We go to the same five bars all the time. I know where to get a good, you know, some good pizza. But, you know, it wasn't until recently when I started going there, almost feeling like a tourist, being like, oh, wow. Yeah, there's all these cool museums, like the Art Institute. Like,
well,
so funny.
Yeah, I mean, maybe that lends itself too to, I mean, you know, I understand that as well. I didn't grow up in a city like Chicago, but you know, you know your certain things, and unless you have someone in your group or a mentor or parent or someone who's like involved in that and who will lead you in that direction and be like, "Hey, you know, we're going to go see some theater tonight." You know, my folks weren't that way. You know, it was just on to baseball practice or football practice and then dinner and then studying. So until I moved to LA, I was pretty much closed off from the artistic community as possible, other than just like watching movies, right? Mm-hmm. Other than that, like I didn't have much experience with museums or theater. There's a Youngstown Playhouse, you know, we'd go on like a field trip every once in a while in school, but there wasn't too much exposure. So I totally understand that. So unless you have someone, especially in a big city like Chicago, it's like you're getting around, and when you're young, you're kind of in your zone, you're doing your thing. So unless you have that person to maybe lead you or guide you into that, I could see that easily happening, you know.
Right.
And
yeah,
then
it's
when you went to LA, did you go right into like acting classes? Like what was your, oh wait, I want you to tell the story.
Which one? I don't know.
Finding an agent.
Oh, which the old lady?
When you called the agency.
Oh yeah. That one.
Do you want to tell that story?
That was when I was still in Chicago. So, okay. So this is my research of moving to Los Angeles and becoming an actor. I Googled acting classes. So that's where I went. There's a place called TVI in Sherman Oaks. It was literally the first thing that popped up, which, you know, I won't talk, you know, about how that experience was, but it was okay. Let's just say that. But I'm like, okay, I need to take acting classes. I get that. I was reading some acting books. I'm like, check. I'm like, now I need an agent. I need to move out to LA and have an agent ready for me, ready to go. So I looked up on IMDb. What agency is Brad Pitt? And I believe at the time it was, I forget which one, it was either CAA or William Morris. Let's go CAA. Mm-hmm. So I looked it up and their phone number's on there. So I'm like, oh, sick. I'll just call and be like, hey, can I talk to Brad Pitt's agent? So I call the girl that answers. I'm like, hey, yeah, so I'm moving out to LA. I just need to get an agent. So yeah, if you guys can represent me, that'd be great. You know, something like that. And she's like, what? She's like, no, that's not how it works. And I'm like, okay, cool. Well, I need to get some acting classes. Can you recommend some place to go to act for acting? And she's just like, no, and just hung up. And that was about it. But yeah, I just called and didn't work. And I remember being like really bummed about it too. I'm like, wow, does she not know? Like, I'm going to be out there soon. Like,
yeah.
Her loss.
First foray into LA. Welcome to the suck.
I wish I would have done that more though. Like I should have just been naive and just called places and figured it out. Cause now I'm like deathly afraid to do something like that. Cause I feel like I'm going to like offend someone or, you know, but it's really, I just said, I'm deathly afraid. I'm not, I don't want to inconvenience people and be like, hey, what's going on? I'm looking for an agent. You know, I don't know. Yeah. It just seems like you're annoying someone.
Well, you're a nice guy. So I can see how you don't want to bother somebody with your
sorry
talents.
To bother you, but
yeah. Well, I crack up at that story because it's symbolic of a lot of us who first moved to LA and got our asses kicked immediately. Yeah. When we, you know, it took me 2 years just to learn the freeway system out there and like get acclimated.
Absolutely. And yeah, it takes a while to get comfortable living in Los Angeles for sure.
Yeah. It's so immense. And I lived there for 11 years and there were still places that I had never been. There are areas and neighborhoods and like places in that city never even crossed. You know, it's just so, there's so much cement and buildings and businesses and just stuff. It takes a while to get acclimated, especially like, you know, you're from the Midwest. It's like you move out there as a young buck in your early 20s. You're just rearing to have a good time, man. You know, grow up in the, I don't know, the cloud belt over here in Illinois, Ohio. It's like, oh, you mean it's sunny every day here? It's like, all right, see you at the beach. Like, you know, it was an experience for sure to get acclimated to the place.
Yeah. I remember just like you said, with the weather, I would just drive around and try to figure out where everything was because yeah, it's so big. There's like so many areas to explore, but it was cool. I actually look back at that kind of fondly, like my first year or so living in LA, like not knowing any better, just driving around and getting myself lost and finding weird places. And it was cool.
When did you start going to the Groundlings?
That was a bit later. It took me a while, like as you said, like moving out here from the Midwest without really having any zero contacts, you know, to kind of be like, where do I go? You know, and I didn't find the Groundlings till later through, I don't even remember how I found it, but I'd say I probably started there maybe like 7 or 8 years ago, something like that, when I first started like a class there. So
are you still taking class there?
I kind of went through their whole program and I got to a certain part called the writing lab. And it's one of those things, it's pretty cutthroat where they're just like yay or nay. Mm-hmm. And you know, after our show, I was a nay. So there was one more kind of class after that. And then that was it. That was pretty much you're either a part of the Sunday company or the Groundlings. And it's really tough. Anybody that's there, that's a current Groundling, is a lot of times they make it up to SNL. But you see them on TV, you know, all the time or working on projects. It's a really talented bunch and you could be a Groundling for as long as you want. So there's kind of, it's similar to SNL, how like Keenan has been a part of the SNL cast forever. You know, if you're a Groundling and you want to hang out, you know, you can be there for as long as you want. So it's pretty tough to get into. But for me, I don't think I ever really, my ambition was never to be a Groundling because I didn't even know what that was when I first started. So for me, it was just to, you know, find a way to be funny and meet other like-minded people. And I definitely got that out of it, which I think was kind of the whole point. So I have good things to say about it. I had a good experience.
Yeah. Well, now you're on to writing and making your own movies. So there's that.
Yeah. Yeah. There we go.
It's like on to the next thing, you know? I think that that's the thing. It's like, especially in the cutthroat world that is the entertainment industry, you know, I don't know how you feel. Like I went through a period and it was probably my entire stretch when I lived in LA in particular, but, holding on so close and identifying yourself so tightly, like claiming your identity as like an actor or a filmmaker, and like so tightly that it was harmful almost mentally, right? And it's like mm-hmm. that, like if something happened where you didn't make the next cut or you don't get this audition or, you know, like you're just getting passed over. If you are tying your identity to those things, to your work so tightly, like that can be so detrimental. And I think that's why a lot of people that don't have a strong head on their shoulders, or at least a practiced mental strength, can really wind up in trouble out there, because of the way the industry works. But I always feel like you've always kept things light. That's why I like being around you and working together with you too, because I feel like you know how to take a step back from kind of the chaos of the industry. At least that's the sense that I get from you, and just kind of do your thing. And it's refreshing, because I know there's people out there, and I'm sure you run into them all the time. It's just like, it's just so demanding for them. And it's like so serious to get to the next level, next place.
I think I learned that. So actually through you, I was doing a lot of background work, and then you got me in with more so doing like stand-in stuff. And I recommend that to anybody that's starting out, like just to be on like a set. And I just noticed that when I got to be on a set with like bigger name actors or bigger name director, they were so much more chill and so just like cool, for lack of a better word. And I just felt like if I was ever in charge of a set, that I would be welcoming, and it wouldn't be like I wouldn't want people to come in and be like nervous about something or doubting themselves. So I think my goal, at least when we did the Dead Body or any of the shorts that I've put together, I'm always like, this is going to be fun. Like I kind of go back to where, when I was a kid and I would go in my parents' basement and we go, let's goof around, you know, let's have a good time. And I think that works the best, because if you're not loose and you're not, you know, having fun, what's the point? Like, the whole point of us ever wanting to perform is because it's fun. Yeah, it's super nerve wracking. I get nervous for every single thing that I do. Even if you're talking about DJing, I've done this forever and I still get a little nervous before I'm about to start. I think that's natural. But then once you get on the stage, there's nothing like it. It's like you're nervous. I'm almost going to throw up. You know, some of these groundling shows, especially, like there's a lot on the line, and like you want to be funny, you want to be there for your scene partner. And you're like, I'm so nervous. Am I funny? Oh my God, do I know my lines? And then you jump out there and boom, it's just like, it's incredible. And then afterwards, it's always, for me, is so fun, because you're just like, remember that and that happened. And it's really crazy. It's really cool. But yeah, I mean, I try to keep it light, as you say, just because I think there are so many people that take it so serious and so dramatic. And it's like, you can be a dramatic actor, but I don't think you have to take yourself super serious.
Yeah. At the end of the day, you're just making entertainment, you know. There's that balance of, I bring balance in everything. I think it's just circles and balance has like become something that I kind of fall back on in life. Instead of going to those extreme, those poles, you know, where things can get a little bit haywire. Being on stage in front of a live audience and trying to be funny is my worst nightmare. So I don't know how you do it.
Yeah, it's tough. Well, I think it's a lot of it too, is, I mean, it's not like one day I'm just like, oh, I'm going to go on stage and, you know, try to make people laugh. It's just like, you've gone through like classes, you've gone through, you know, a bunch of different improv and sketch, you know, exercises and you know, time with your classmates and stuff. So to me, I've always felt really close to the people in my improv groups, because you've kind of been together and worked on stuff and you trust them. To me, the thing that's the most scary is stand-up. I have no desire to do stand-up comedy, and I just admire that skill so much. You're literally on stage on your own, and people pay money to be like, make me laugh. Like, I feel like at least with like improv and sketch, for the most part, it's an ensemble. You typically have a scene partner. You have some monologues here and there, but typically have a scene partner. So it's like, if I'm not being funny, then hopefully the person across from me is like doing something that's great, saving me, you know.
Where do you get your ideas from?
Ooh, that's a great question. I don't know. I don't know if you're like this. I'm just all over the board. Like, most of it is actual experience. Like, I'll be somewhere. I'm kind of always observing, and might be something actually from The Groundlings where we observe people and then bring them in as a character. So I think I'm really into characters. So I'll be anywhere, you know, and just be like, oh my God, that person's being insane right now. But then like kind of being like, let me jot that down, you know? So I kind of like will find stuff, or if something like happens in my day to day and I'm like, huh, that's interesting, you know, I'll write that down and maybe it'll become something. So I think for me, it's personal experiences that kind of just lead my imagination somewhere. I don't really know exactly though.
Yeah, it makes sense. I mean, your own experiences you're going to draw from and stuff that you are around or see. I'm always the person that my friends either hate because I will stick around. Like if some odd character comes around, you know, I'm going to talk to him. And my friends, like, you know, I'll like buy my, like friends will leave the table. Like this has happened where I've been like out and some weirdo comes over and starts like trying to talk to us, and like half my friends will like leave and I'll just dive in.
Yeah.
I'm like, this guy's interesting. I'm going to at least take like something from them. And I've done that in the past where it's like, I met this weird dude in Vegas and he had this like grainy, raspy voice. And I pulled that voice and used it for a sketch character.
Yeah, that's
you
great.
Know? And so unless you like put yourself in those scenarios, you're not going to like have that experience or learn from it. My friends will always just be like, why are you talking to that guy?
Like, dude, I love that. I love that story.
Forget about it. You know, it's like he's in the library now. He's in there. So if I never need to pull something, you know, you just write it down. But yeah, ideas are weird. I mean, it's like you said with Dead Body, it just can either come, right? It's like boom, boom, boom. Mm-hmm. I always keep like, I think I've told you this, like I have like in my notes section on my phone, in particular, this one page, I'll just jot mm-hmm. stuff, or even if it's a dumb idea, and then wait and then revisit it. And then if it makes the cut, I'll put it into like a Word doc of like a numbered document of ideas and stuff. And be like, okay, this could either be a short film, or, oh, this one could maybe be turned into a feature. But at least like those crazy ideas are down on paper. But it sounds like you're kind of similar in the way that you come up yeah. with stuff.
I love when it happens though. It's like so exciting. And then I'll even think of that too. I'll be like, oh, here's an idea. I'm like, let's just see what happens in life. And eventually I'll probably think of some other things that I'll go on to it. We saw a movie recently. I forget the name of it. It's with Charlie Hunnam and Hugh Grant. I can't remember. Matthew McConaughey's in there too.
Oh, bunch of hunks.
I don't know why I could. Yeah, bunch of hunks.
What is this? What is this hunky film that you're
I don't know. Should
of?
We look it up real quick?
Yeah. Yeah, we got interwebs here.
I've been telling the story, and I should know the name of the movie.
The one where for it.
What's up? Oh no, The Gentleman. It's called The Gentleman.
The Gentleman.
And it's written and directed by Guy Ritchie. So the very beginning of the have you seen it?
No.
Okay.
But I know the film you're talking about, because I think it was on my list of like, oh, I gotta check that out.
Yeah. So this idea came to me. This is kind of like led to my next thing I want to shoot is the very beginning of the film, Charlie Hunnam's character turns on the lights and Hugh Grant is already in the living room, like looking very sinister, like he'd been waiting for him. And we've seen that trope in so many movies where, mm-hmm. you know, the good guy comes home and the bad guy's waiting for him. Where have you been? Or whatever it is. And I just was watching that and I go, I wonder what Hugh Grant was doing the whole time. Do you think he was waiting there like a while? Like how did he know Charlie Hunnam was coming home? What time was he going to come home? Did he know? I'm like, he could have been there for hours. And I'm like, and if he was, did he use the restroom? Was he hungry? Did he crack open the fridge? So I was just like, I looked over at my poor wife who deals with all my ideas, which the majority are stinkers. And I started telling her, I'm like, where do you think he was? What do you think he was doing in there? She's just like, watch the movie, moron. But no, it kind of led to this idea. Like, I'm like, what does happen with that? So that's kind of the thing I'm writing right now, is kind of like the story of the guy coming in, he sneaks in the house and he's waiting around, and then he, you know, person's not coming. So he's like, I'm kind of hungry, you know?
So that's awesome.
So that's where that idea came from. And kind of like from there, just like, I just kind of just kept coming up with weird ideas.
I love that. You definitely have to make that.
Oh yeah. It's been written. So yeah, that's the next thing I want to shoot.
Yeah.
That would just be a short, I believe.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a great call. I can totally see you doing that too. So what's next on the horizon? You have this feature film that is under your belt. It's an award winning. You're an award winning director now, which is wild.
Nice.
Do you want to do another one? Do you want to focus on acting for a little while? What do you think?
I love acting. Yeah. I just had a audition yesterday for like a Christmas, series. And now that I mentioned it, I probably am not going to get it, but, no, so I definitely love acting. And now that I've like been there and kind of done some filmmaking, I realize, you know, easier is the wrong word, but it's just, you don't have to worry quite as much about anything else. If you could act and really, like I said, be in your character and give it your all and, you know, have a fun day on set, you know, there's nothing like it. I love performing. But if I have something that I feel very passionate about, and, you know, at least for me, I haven't had a lot of luck when it comes to, you know, booking a lot of TV and film as an actor. I kind of think of myself, even though I'm completely different, I admire Seth Rogen in the sense that if he didn't know how to write and direct and produce, we probably wouldn't really even know Seth Rogen that well. He's just done such a great job of like creating content for himself. So that's kind of where I'm at, where I like to be. And I think it's great to create your own stuff, because then you could bring in, you know, your friends and people you like working with and kind of be in charge of it. So there's just something about that and like creating a story that no one else has told and you're telling it. So I really want to do another. I didn't know if I wanted to do another feature, because during it, I'm like, man, this is a lot of work. But now that it's actually getting some like attention, and, you know, it's very cool to be like, hey, my movie is going to be at the theater. Check it out. You know, so I don't think I'm ever going to not want to create content and shoot something. So I definitely see another feature and features, you know, to come. So,
yeah, it's like almost the Mark Duplass theory on filmmaking and career that I've adopted a little bit, in terms of not putting so much pressure on myself in terms of getting parts, letting other people decide for me. I think a lot of folks now, at least in the entertainment industry, in terms of like being an actor, being a writer, being a filmmaker, in some kind of combination of that, you're seeing so much more of that, because you can go get a camera and film yourself. And I would say that for any like aspiring actor out there, one thing that learning how to write, because that was my process, right? I was like struggling as an actor, not getting parts. I don't really have a commercial face. I'm not, you know, this like leading man type. So I don't think people knew what to do with me. I'm not really that funny, but I can be dramatic. You know, it's like,
you are funny, just so you know.
I don't feel like it. But I almost didn't know what to do with myself as an actor. I always admired probably the darker, deeper stuff, like the Daniel Day-Lewis style, and admire that so much. But I think the ability to, what happened for me was not getting a lot of parts as an actor forced me to start writing for myself and then make my own stuff. And that led me into filmmaking. And I love every single aspect of it, because everyone's always like, well, which one would you do if you had a choice? And I'm like, all of them. Like, it's not, I hate that question. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, I mean, I love acting so much, and I feel so good when I'm just an actor on a set. Like there's something so awesome about that, and just being able to focus on that and dive into that character. But I also love creating, like making my own thing from my vision. And I would say, like, to any aspiring actor, you would probably agree to this. It's like, learn how to, you know, pick up a couple writing books, and start to learn how to tell a story, and then go shoot a movie on your iPhone or shoot something every weekend with a couple people. And you'll start to, what it's going to do is it's going to start to take a lot of pressure off of you in the audition room. Because I don't know how you feel, Andy, but I did this too. When I started making my own stuff, when I made my first short film, Liliana, which is not really a short film because it's like 40 minutes. But I was like, oh, I can make my own stuff. Like, and again, it's not at the level of like being in a big studio film, but knowing that you can craft something and be able to work on something that you created is pretty special. And we've only really gotten into this period since, like, I was talking about this with Andre, like 2006, 2007, 2008, when kind of the consumer grade camera started coming out, and then the iPhones, and you had the ability then where it's like, you didn't need hundreds of thousands of dollars to go make a movie. You can make one cheap. And I don't know, it just took a lot of pressure off me as an actor. Not to say that I book all kinds of stuff, but I'm also in the Midwest and the market's not really great for acting here. But I do know, like, when I go into audition rooms now, or even making a self tape, I'm kind of like, look, this is my opportunity to act. I'm going to give you what I got and then leave it at the door. Like, I'm not going to think about it after I submit that or walk out of that audition room, because I know I can go make something that I can write for myself, that I can like create the character that I want to play. And there's so much power in that.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I don't know how because you've kind of gone through that transition as well. I don't know how you feel about that as well.
Yeah. I mean, I totally agree with what you're saying. And like, one thing I've really learned that I wasn't expecting, I think I have always had a tough time with, like, even you saying award-winning director, I can't even say it.
Yeah.
Award-winning director. Like, to me, it's weird. I'm like, that's not me. You know, maybe it's like that imposter syndrome, whatever people talk about, but it's almost like, I'm like, I can't fathom that that's a thing. And like, even like our film now, like seeing that, you know, it's not like I had producers, you know, I didn't have anybody putting a big amount of money into it. And just to see that, you know, like I said, it was on a screen a couple of weeks ago, and I saw other films also that were on a screen, and like, our film looks really good. And to be like, wow, this looks really great. And like, you know, created a team that was talented and, you know, put the right pieces together, and you got a good product. And I think there's a lot of, for me, confidence building with that, to be like, yeah, I'll audition for your film. But yeah, like you said, like knowing that, hey, I was able to make one of these as well. I made a film. And I can do that, you know, so I can act in your movie, but I can also make my own movie. You know, it's just like a really cool thing to kind of like find out about yourself, to be kind of amazed, to be like, oh, I can do that too. Cause I think you always think, like, I know, at least, especially for me early on, and still, you know, I think of like, you know, directors or producers or casting directors, anybody that's kind of like in charge of our career in a sense. Like, I always think of them as these big, you know, mountains to climb, but I'm finding out more and more, you know, as I get more experience, it's kind of like, no, they're just kind of like messing around too. And they just been successful at it. So they just keep getting to make things. I always think of, my idol's Tarantino, but just to see, like, he's just the guy that loved movies and he made Reservoir Dogs, and like, I'm sure, I don't know, you know, much about, you know, the onset experience, obviously, with his movies, but just to be like, that just seems like such a fun movie. Like, that just seemed like so much fun. Pretty much just shot primarily in one location. And then from there, you know, he skyrockets. And to me, it just seems like, I could be wrong, but it seems like he's just having fun. And he's just a guy that's just like Edgar Wright too. I love all his films. It just seems like a fun time. And I'm like, man, these guys are just, you know, obviously there's a lot to it. It's not just fun all the time, but just finding myself being like, yeah, maybe that'll happen. Like, not to that level, but maybe I could have a career in this. You know, it's like something that you never really thought could happen without all these other people helping. But now to be like, oh yeah, maybe that can happen for us with, you know, kind of the people that I've been around.
Yeah. It's a strategy to do it. your own way and not wait for people to give you permission to make something. And that's the strategy that I've been forced into. And you've definitely made something that's a lot of fun, and you can carry that into the next thing for sure. Andy also he acts in Dead Body, and he's awesome in it. So yeah, RJ. RJ is quite the character. Do you have a favorite film from this year that you've been like kind of thinking about?
Like a film that came out this year?
Yeah, like I'll even give you like back to 2020.
Yeah.
2020 or 2021. Has there been a movie that's either inspired you or has like left you thinking about, oh, it'd be really cool to make something like that or act in a film like that? Has there been anything on your radar?
Yeah, the last couple of movies, I guess a good shout out for Evolution of Movies podcast that you were a special guest on a few weeks. But two movies that we just talked about that happened in the last couple of years that I just like, they're so different. But for me, like kind of in my wheelhouse is A Game Night with Jason Bateman, and also Get Out, you know, Jordan Peele's film. And just those two films for me are just, I mean, they're completely different, but they're just so different. Like Get Out, like if you're like, what's Get Out about? You can't be like, oh, it's kind of like Fast and the Furious meets, you know, there's no way you could really describe that movie. And I think it's one of my favorite movies of all time, because it's just so weird and different and creepy and well acted. It's just, man. And then Game Night, completely different, such a comedy, but it's comedy with, you know, some great acting and there's some, you know, shooting and killing and like, you know, totally like up my alley. And yeah, both of those movies, like those are the first two at least that came to mind. They're just so unique.
Yeah, Game Night's awesome.
Yeah.
Jesse Plemons is one of my favorite actors.
He is so good in
that
too.
He's so good. And he's in a new Netflix film that everyone's raving about, I guess. The one with Benedict Cumberbatch.
Oh, yeah. With his wife too, right? Something. Kirsten Dunst, isn't she in that too?
Yeah.
This is a great time of year because this is, you know, screener time of year for SAG. So
yeah,
I'm old school. I like when they send me the DVDs.
Yeah, me too. Still got a working DVD player.
Yeah. Yeah, keep it fresh just for this time of year.
That physical copy. I have a like one of those books that you can put the discs in. I still have like a couple of those filled.
Oh, I keep all the screeners. I know it says you're supposed to like burn them afterwards.
But... Yeah, no, I mean, we burn them. We throw, we crack them.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
Throw them away.
I
mean, every year.
I destroy them. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was struggling at asking that question, like thinking for myself. Of some films that have inspired me lately. I've actually had to kind of go back to the well and like watch some older stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I watched Stalker by Tarkovsky, you know, the Russian filmmaker Tarkovsky.
Yeah.
From like,
I know the name. I don't
70s.
Know the film though.
Most people have never seen him, but his stuff is visually extremely unique and, it's a little out there, a lot of his stuff, but Stalker was really, really an interesting film to watch, and somewhat inspiring just from like the visual storytelling standpoint of things. And sometimes I'll have to remind myself when I'm either writing or trying to come up with a story idea to remember that making films, like you're telling a visual story too. You know, not mm-hmm. just like vomiting words all over the page. And that's a really great example. He's a great example of going back and looking at like the visual stuff. And but you can't also like, you can also get into trouble by like being trying to be too cute and unique and trying to tell a story just with your visuals instead of, you know, story structure and good mm-hmm. acting and dialogue when it's needed. But anyway, that that was just kind of off the topic question that I was kind of curious to see if you have
another film though that I really like that I don't think has been getting a lot of attention, but you watched it as well, is Guilty with Jake Gyllenhaal.
Yeah.
I just love his work. He's for me, top five favorite actors. And he just, man, that guy, like that, like, so like we talk about how, like, I kind of moved to comedy. I feel just more comfortable there where like, I know it would take a lot of work and practice to do anything that he did in that film. He's just so good. And I just look at that and I go, that's amazing. Like, I don't even know how, I wouldn't even know where to get started. Like, that's just, it's crazy to me. He's just so good.
Yeah. I feel like he's an actor that we take for granted.
Mm-hmm.
He's extremely talented. In particular, mm-hmm. like, you watch Guilty, because I watched Zodiac again for like mm-hmm. the 10th time. Because I always go back to like Fincher films. If I want a certain mood, I'll watch a film or I'll rewatch based on like, I want a certain feeling or mood. And Fincher usually provides that for me in certain ways.
Yeah.
But in like Zodiac, he's so meek and young, and like, compared to his character that he plays in, you know, Nightcrawler.
Oof,
or Guilty.
That one's so
it's
good.
Just like he's Prisoners. Like, he's got mm-hmm. a lot of dimensions. He can play that like everyman type, but he's so much deeper in terms of what he brings. So yeah, Guilty was good. The film itself, like, you know, take it or leave it, but his performance for me was top notch. We'll see if he gets nommed for that one.
He really should. I think it's interesting with movies. Like, I was talking about Training Day with somebody recently, and like, take Denzel out of that movie. It's okay. It's good. Like, it'll probably be pretty good. But if you have the right actor in the right, oh my God, he is so good as Alonzo. Like, it's amazing. Like, if you put anybody else in there, like, it's probably a movie you'd be like, oh yeah, that Training Day movie. But now you say Training Day, people are like, oh, Denzel like kills it in that movie. So I think kind of similar with Guilty, you could have put anybody else in there and you'd probably be like, yeah, I saw that movie, but then put him in it and you're like, oh yeah, I'll watch that movie again.
You know,
just because of his performance.
Casting is so crucial because you could almost have 10 different films based on who you have portray some of these characters, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if that translates into like theater as well. Like, there's been so many people that have played Macbeth,
mm-hmm.
but I feel like still for whatever reason, like, Macbeth is bigger than the actor. Like, there's certain plays or stories that will always be bigger than the actor. And maybe it doesn't necessarily mean as much, but I don't know if it's different because it's film and you're just so much more close and intimate. Like, changing something up like that, like, yeah, it can totally change the film. And who knows, like, how many movies that did not come out that well, that maybe they didn't either have the ability to cast who they wanted, but still were like, well, we can get you this guy and you can make a film with him. And you're like, all right.
Yeah. You know? I always think of did you see the, it's like Movies That Made Us, that's on Netflix. It's like,
yeah, the mini documentaries. Worth it?
There's a bunch of them. I think there's like 10 of them or something now. But the Back to the Future one's great because they talk about, you know, Eric Stoltz was originally Marty, and he came in and just was kind of like, I think he was like dressed in like dark clothing and kind of took it very like serious. And then Michael J. Fox came in and brought like this whole, you know, iconic Marty McFly character. And it's just like, if you made that movie with Eric Stoltz, he's a great actor, but just not the same movie. But now people, I mean, that's for me, again, that's probably top five favorite movies. I love Back to the Future.
Yeah, I would agree. Yeah. An example of how like important casting is. It can make or break your film. Like, mm-hmm. it's either, you know, it's like in Stoltz, like you said, he's a good actor. He's just not right for that part.
Yeah,
and there's movies that they saw it immediately. You know, they're like, right. This isn't working. You know,
good for them. It, like, you should watch that. Yeah, because they put a lot of money and time into the movie already. Who knows if you're a producer or whatever, and you might just go, let's just let's just do it. We're already this far in, but somebody was like, nope, we got to change it.
And that's a great example of, if you're an actor listening to this, why you should never take it personally if you don't get cast for a part.
Yeah.
I mean, truly do not take it personally, because if you just don't fit, like, you can be great. And anyone who gets to the callback session, like, they recognize your talent. So go ahead and pat yourself on the back at that point. But from there, it's kind of out of your hands. You just have to show up and do your job and do your work. And it's not up to you, unfortunately, at that point, unless you're writing and directing your own film. Right, Andy?
Yeah, absolutely. I actually have a story for you that I just told somebody.
Yeah.
So I had a commercial, and it was going to be for a Super Bowl commercial. And what I was doing as an actor was every actor's dream. They're like, you're going to be in a motorcycle, and then you get to fight the bad guys, and you're zipping through the city. And it's with Liam Neeson is in the ad. And I'm like, amazing. So I got to call back, and I got to the part where they're like, what's your availability? You know, all that stuff. And I'm like, oh my God, you know? So I'm like, it's me and whoever, just a couple other people. And never got the call, and always wondered, you know, who booked that. So on Super Bowl, I made sure, you know, I was ready for that commercial. And sure enough, it's this guy zipping around in the motorcycle, and there's Liam Neeson. And I look up the actor, and I'm like, I don't recognize that guy. I'm not sure who he is, but I did a little investigative work. It's Liam Neeson's son that booked the part. So I was kind of like, you know what? There's nothing I could have possibly done. You know, he just probably said, let's use my son. And then that was it.
Yeah.
So what can you do?
I mean, I wonder if they had to just have the auditions just for the purpose of the nepotism aspect of like, we tried, but we'll just cast a son.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, at least, I mean, but that's got to make you feel better. Like, I mean, you're not beating up Neeson's kid.
And a lot of times you'll see there's a Butterfinger commercial that's running right now called the BFI. It's this guy that's like an investigator. And he's awesome. And I auditioned for it, and I was like, yeah, that guy's way better. Like, good choice. So, you know.
Yeah.
What can you do?
It's all good. It's all good. And yeah, don't take it personally. And if you do, go make your own stuff. Make your own stuff regardless. You take it.
You know?
So this is awesome, man. Is there anything else that you wanted to cross off the checklist here in terms of acting, filmmaking? Anything you want to talk about?
I mean, you and I could talk for hours, and I appreciate this. I love it. I think everything we talked about is great. We'll have to do a part two in the future.
We will definitely do a part two, because there's so much, like you said, to go over and discuss in the world of what we're involved with, and we could talk movies for days. So I appreciate you coming on here, man. Tell everyone where to find you on social.
Yeah. You could find me at just Andy Rossi, literally JUST Andy Rossi, and at Dead Body Movie, if you want to keep up with what's going on with our film.
And I will link all of those things down in the comments section. If you're listening on Spotify or iTunes or watching on YouTube. So what you can do now, you can watch us talk to each other through a screen.
It's pretty cool. How exciting for them.
Yeah. So Dead Body, the movie, Andy Rossi, you're awesome. Thanks so much for doing this. It's great to see your fresh face. It's always a pleasure.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, buddy.
All right, buddy. Take care, man.
All right, later.
All right, bye, everyone. All right, thank you so much, everyone, for taking the time to listen to my conversation with Andy Rossi. Definitely check out some of his links below. I've included the Dead Body trailer for your enjoyment, and I'll update everyone once the film does have a final resting place where you can go watch that movie and hopefully get some laughs from it. So once again, you can subscribe to the ArtWalk newsletter at artwalk.substack.com if you haven't already done so, where this podcast will be updated. And once again, you can watch it on YouTube, you can listen to it on Spotify, iTunes, or Google Podcasts. And I hope everyone has a great rest of the day. Thanks for spending some time with me. And I hope you guys are getting some enjoyment and maybe a little bit of knowledge out of these podcasts. Once again, I'd love for you to just share with one person who you think might get some enjoyment out of this, or the newsletter itself, the 5 cool things, which comes to your inbox every Friday. It's a nice and simple structure with some things on film and television, music and art that is a nice quick read and a resource for you to go check some cool stuff out. So thanks again, everyone, and peace.